In Search of the Miraculous, Chapter 8. At one of the following lectures, G returned to the question of consciousness. Neither the psychical nor the physical functions of man can be understood, he said, unless the fact has been grasped that they can both work in different states of consciousness. In all, there are four states of consciousness possible for man. He emphasised the word man. But ordinary man, that is, man number one, number two and number three, lives in the two lowest states of consciousness only. The two higher states of consciousness are inaccessible to him, and although he may have flashes of these states, he is unable to understand them, and he judges them from the point of view of those states in which it is usual for him to be. The two usual, that is, the lowest, states of consciousness are first, sleep, in other words, a passive state in which man spends a third and very often a half of his life, and second, the state in which men spend the other part of their lives, in which they walk the streets, write books, talk on lofty subjects, take part in politics, kill one another, which they regard as active, and call clear consciousness, or the waking state of consciousness. The term clear consciousness, or waking state of consciousness, seems to have been given in jest, especially when you realise what clear consciousness ought in reality to be, and what the state in which man lives and acts really is. The third state of consciousness is self-remembering, or self-consciousness, or consciousness of one's being. It is usual to consider that we have this state of consciousness, or that we can have it if we want to. Our science and philosophy have overlooked the fact that we do not possess this state of consciousness and that we cannot create it in ourselves by decision or desire alone. The fourth state of consciousness is called the objective state of consciousness. In this state, a man can see things as they are. Flashes of this state of consciousness also occur in man. In the religions of all nations, there are indications of the possibility of a state of consciousness of this kind, which is called enlightenment, and various other names, but which cannot be described in words. But the only right way to objective consciousness is through the development of self-consciousness. If an ordinary man is artificially brought into a state of objective consciousness, and afterwards brought back to his usual state, he will remember nothing, and he will think that for a time he had lost consciousness. But in the state of self-consciousness, a man can have flashes of objective consciousness and remember them. The fourth state of consciousness in man means an altogether different state of being. It is the result of inner growth and of long and difficult work on oneself. But the third state of consciousness constitutes the natural right of man as he is, and if man does not possess it, it is only because of the wrong conditions of his life. It can be said without any exaggeration that at the present time the third state of consciousness occurs in man only in the form of very rare flashes, and that it can be made more or less permanent in him only by means of special training. For most people, even for educated and thinking people, the chief obstacle in the way of acquiring self-consciousness consists in the fact that they think they possess it, that is, that they possess self-consciousness and everything connected with it. Individuality in the sense of a permanent and unchangeable I, will, ability to do, and so on. It is evident that a man will not be interested if you tell him that he can acquire by long and difficult work something which, in his opinion, he already has. On the contrary, he will think either that you are mad or that you want to deceive him with a view to personal gain. The two higher states of consciousness, self-consciousness and objective consciousness, are connected with the functioning of the higher centres in man. In addition to those centres of which we have so far spoken, there are two other centres in man, the higher emotional and the higher thinking. These centres are in us, they are fully developed and are working all the time, but their work fails to reach our ordinary consciousness. The cause of this lies in the special properties of our so-called clear consciousness. In order to understand what the difference between states of consciousness is, let us return to the first state of consciousness, which is sleep. This is an entirely subjective state of consciousness. A man is immersed in dreams. Whether he remembers them or not does not matter. Even if some real impressions reach him, such as sounds, voices, warmth, cold, then sensation of his own body, they arouse in him only fantastic subjective images. Then a man wakes up. At first glance, this is a quite different state of consciousness. He can move, he can talk with other people, he can make calculations ahead, he can see danger and avoid it, and so on. It stands to reason that he is in a better position than when he was asleep. But if we go a little more deeply into things, if we take a look into his inner world, into his thoughts, into the causes of his actions, we shall see that he is in almost the same state as when he is asleep. And it is even worse, because in sleep he is passive, that is, he cannot do anything. In the waking state, however, he can do something all the time, and the results of all his actions will be reflected upon him or upon those around him. And yet he does not remember himself. He is a machine. Everything with him happens. He cannot stop the flow of his thoughts. He cannot control his imagination, his emotions, his attention. He lives in a subjective world of I love, I do not love, I like, I do not like, I want, I do not want. That is, of what he thinks he likes, of what he thinks he does not like, of what he thinks he wants, of what he thinks he does not want. He does not see the real world. The real world is hidden from him by the wall of imagination. He lives in sleep. He is asleep. What is called clear consciousness is sleep, and a far more dangerous sleep than sleep at night in bed. Let us take some event in the life of humanity, for instance, war. There is a war going on at the present moment. What does it signify? It signifies that several millions of sleeping people are trying to destroy several millions of other sleeping people. They would not do this, of course, if they were to wake up. Everything that takes place is owing to this sleep. Both states of consciousness, sleep and the waking state, are equally subjective. Only by beginning to remember himself does a man really awaken. And then all surrounding life acquires for him a different aspect and a different meaning. He sees that it is the life of sleeping people, a life in sleep. All that men say, all that they say and do in sleep. All this can have no value whatever. Only awakening and what leads to awakening has a value in reality. How many times have I been asked whether wars can be stopped? Certainly they can. For this, it is only necessary that people should awaken. It seems a small thing. It is, however, the most difficult thing there can be, because this sleep is induced and maintained by the whole of surrounding life, by all surrounding conditions. How can one awaken? How can one escape this sleep? These questions are the most important, the most vital that can ever confront a man. But before this, it is necessary to be convinced of the very fact of sleep. But it is possible to be convinced of this only by trying to awaken. When a man understands that he does not remember himself, and that to remember himself means to awaken to some extent, and when at the same time he sees by experience how difficult it is to remember himself, he will understand that he cannot awaken simply by having the desire to do so. It can be said still more precisely that a man cannot awaken by himself. But if, let us say, 20 people make an agreement that whoever of them awakens first shall wake the rest, they already have some chance. Even this, however, is insufficient, because all the 20 can go to sleep at the same time and dream that they are waking up. Therefore, more still is necessary. They must be looked after by a man who is not asleep, or who does not fall asleep as easily as they do, or who goes to sleep consciously when this is possible, when it will do no harm either to himself or to others. They must find such a man and hire him to wake them and not allow them to fall asleep again. Without this, it is impossible to awaken. This is what must be understood. It is possible to think for 1,000 years. It is possible to write whole libraries of books, to create theories by the million, and all this in sleep without any possibility of awakening. On the contrary, these books and these theories, written and created in sleep, will merely send other people to sleep and so on. There is nothing new in the idea of sleep. People have been told almost since the creation of the world that they are asleep and that they must awaken. How many times is this said in the Gospels, for instance? Awake, watch, sleep not. Christ's disciples even slept when he was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane for the last time. It is all there. But do men understand it? Men take it simply as a form of speech, as an expression, as a metaphor. They completely fail to understand that it must be taken literally. And again, it is easy to understand why. In order to understand this literally, it is necessary to awaken a little, or at least to try to awaken. I tell you seriously that I have been asked several times why nothing is said about sleep in the Gospels, although it is there spoken of almost on every page. This simply shows that people read the Gospels in sleep. So long as a man sleeps profoundly and is wholly immersed in dreams, he cannot even think about the fact that he is asleep. If he were to think that he was asleep, he would wake up. So everything goes on. And men have not the slightest idea what they are losing because of this sleep. As I have already said, as he is organized, that is, being such as nature has created him, man can be a self-conscious being. Such he is created and such he is born. But he is born among sleeping people, and, of course, he falls asleep among them just at the very time when he should have begun to be conscious of himself. Everything has a hand in this. The involuntary imitation of older people are on the part of the child, voluntary and involuntary suggestion, and what is called education. Every attempt to awaken on the child's part is instantly stopped. This is inevitable. And a great many efforts and a great deal of help are necessary in order to awaken later when thousands of sleep-compelling habits have been accumulated. And this very seldom happens. In most cases, a man, when still a child, already loses the possibility of awakening. He lives in sleep all his life and he dies in sleep. Furthermore, many people die long before their physical death. But of such cases we will speak later on. Now turn your attention to what I've pointed out to you before. A fully developed man, which I call man in the full sense of the word, should possess 4 states of consciousness. Ordinary man, that is man number 1, number 2 and number 3, lives in 2 states of consciousness only. He knows, or at least he can know, of the existence of the 4th state of consciousness. All these mystical states and so on are wrong definitions, but when they are not deceptions or imitations, they are flashes of what we call an objective state of consciousness. But man does not know of the 3rd state of consciousness or even suspect it. Nor can he suspect it because if you were to explain to him what the 3rd state of consciousness is, that is to say, in what it consists, he would say that it was his usual state. He considers himself to be a conscious being governing his own life. Facts that contradict that, he considers to be accidental or temporary, which will change by themselves. By considering that he possesses self-consciousness, as it were by nature, a man will not, of course, try to approach or obtain it. And yet, without self-consciousness or the 3rd state, the 4th, except in rare flashes, is impossible. Knowledge, however, the real objective knowledge towards which man, as he asserts, is struggling, is possible only in the 4th state of consciousness. That is, it is conditional upon the full possession of the 4th state of consciousness. Knowledge which is acquired in the ordinary state of consciousness is intermixed with dreams. There you have a complete picture of the being of man number one, number two, and number three. G began the next talk as follows. Man's possibilities are very great. You cannot conceive even a shadow of what man is capable of attaining. But nothing can be attained in sleep. In the consciousness of a sleeping man, his illusions, his dreams are mixed with reality. He lives in a subjective world and he can never escape from it. And this is the reason why he can never make use of all the powers he possesses and why he always lives in only a small part of himself. It has been said before that self-study and self-observation, if rightly conducted, bring man to the realization of the fact that something is wrong with his machine and with his functions in their ordinary state. A man realizes that it is precisely because he is asleep that he lives and works in a small part of himself. It is precisely for this reason that the vast majority of his possibilities remain unrealized. The vast majority of his powers are left unused. A man feels that he does not get out of life all that it can give him, that he fails to do so owing to definite functional defects in his machine, in his receiving apparatus. The idea of self-study acquires in his eyes a new meaning. He feels that possibly it may not even be worthwhile studying himself as he is now. He sees every function as it is now and as it could or be or ought to be. Self-observation brings man to the realization of the necessity for self-change. And in observing himself, a man notices that self-observation itself brings about certain changes in his inner processes. He begins to understand that self-observation is an instrument of self-change, a means of awakening. By observing himself, he throws, as it were, a ray of light onto his inner process, which have hitherto worked in complete darkness. And under the influence of this light, the processes themselves begin to change. There are a great many chemical processes that can take place only in the absence of light. Exactly in the same way, many psychic processes can take place only in the dark. Even a feeble light of consciousness is enough to change completely the character of a process, while it makes many of them altogether impossible. Our inner psychic processes, our inner alchemy, have much in common with those chemical processes in which light changes the character of the process, and they are subject to analogous laws. When a man comes to realize the necessity not only for self-study and self-observation, but also for work on himself with the object of changing himself, the character of his self-observation must change. He has so far studied the details of the work of the centres, trying only to register this or that phenomenon, to be an impartial witness. He has studied the work of the machine. Now he must begin to see himself, that is to say, to see, not separate details, not the work of small wheels and levers, but to see everything taken together as a whole, the whole of himself such as others see him. For this purpose, a man must learn to take, so to speak, mental photographs of himself at different moments of his life and in different emotional states, and not photographs of details, but photographs of the whole as he saw it. In other words, these photographs must contain simultaneously everything that a man can see in himself at a given moment. Emotions, moods, thoughts, sensations, postures, movements, tones of voice, facial expressions, and so on. If a man succeeds and sees an interesting moment for these photographs, he will very soon collect a whole album of pictures of himself which, taken altogether, will show him quite clearly what he is. But it is not easy to learn how to take these photographs at the most interesting and characteristic moments, how to catch characteristic postures, characteristic facial expressions, characteristic emotions and characteristic thoughts. If the photographs are taken successfully and if there is a sufficient number of them, a man will see that his usual conception of himself, with which he has lived from year to year, is very far from reality. Instead of the man he had supposed himself to be, he will see quite another man. This other man is himself, and at the same time not himself. It is he as other people know him, as he imagines himself and as he appears in his actions, words and so on, but not altogether such as he actually is. For a man himself knows that there is a great deal that is unreal, invented and artificial in this other man whom other people know and whom he knows himself. You must learn to divide the real from the invented, and to begin self-observation and self-study it is necessary to divide oneself. A man must realise that he indeed consists of two men. One is the man he calls I, and whom others call Ouspensky, Sakharov or Petrov. The other is the real he, the real I, which appears in his life only for very short moments, and which can become firm and permanent only after a very lengthy period of work. So long as a man takes himself as one person, he will never move from where he is. His work on himself starts from the moment when he begins to feel two men in himself. One is passive, and the most it can do is to register or observe what is happening to it. The other, which calls itself I, is active and speaks of itself in the first person, is in reality only Ouspensky, Petrov or Zakharov. This is the first realisation that a man can have. Having began to think correctly, he very soon sees that he is completely in the power of his Ouspensky, Petrov or Zakharov. No matter what he plans or what he intends to do or say, it is not he, not I, that will carry it out, do or say it, but his Ouspensky, Petrov or Zakharov, and of course they will do or say it, not in the way I would have done or said it, but in their own way, with their own shade of meaning, and often this shade of meaning completely changes what I wanted to do. From this point of view, there is a very definite danger arising from the very first moment of self-observation. It is I who begins self-observation, but it is immediately taken up and continued by Ouspensky, Sakharov or Petrov. But Ouspensky, Sakharov or Petrov, from the very first steps, introduces a slight alteration into this self-observation, an alteration which seems to be quite unimportant, but which in reality fundamentally alters the whole thing. Let us suppose, for example, that a man called Ivanov hears the description of this method of self-observation. He is told that a man must divide himself, he or I on one side, and Ouspensky, Petrov or Zakharov on the other. And he divides himself literally as he hears it. This is I, he says, and that is Ouspensky, Petrov or Zakharov. He will never say Ivanov. He finds that unpleasant, so he will inevitably use somebody else's surname or Christian name. Moreover, he calls I what he likes, himself or at any rate what he considers to be strong, while he calls Ouspensky, Petrov or Sakharov what he does not like or what he considers to be weak. On this basis, he begins to reason in many ways about himself, quite wrongly, of course, from the very beginning, since he has already deceived himself in the most important point and has taken not his real self. That is, he has not taken Ivanov, but the imaginary Ouspensky, Petrov or Zakharov. It is difficult even to imagine how often a man dislikes to use his own name in speaking of himself in the third person. He tries to avoid it in every possible way. He calls himself by another name, as in the instance just mentioned. He devises an artificial name for himself, a name by which nobody ever has or will ever call him. Or he calls himself simply he, and so on. In this connection, people are accustomed in their mental conversations to call themselves by their Christian name or surname, or by pet names, are no exception. When it comes to self-observation, they prefer to call themselves Ouspensky or to say Ouspensky in me, as though there could be an Ouspensky in them. There is quite enough of Ouspensky for Ouspensky himself. But when a man understands his helplessness in the face of Ouspensky, his attitude towards himself and towards Ouspensky in him ceases to be either indifferent or unconcerned. Self-observation becomes observation of Ouspensky. A man understands that he is not Ouspensky, that Ouspensky is nothing but the mask he wears, the part that he unconsciously plays and which, unfortunately, he cannot stop playing, a part which rules him and makes him do and say thousands of stupid things, thousands of things of which he would never do or say himself. If he is sincere with himself, he feels that he is in the power of Ouspensky, and at the same time he feels that he is not Ouspensky. He begins to be afraid of Ouspensky, begins to feel that he is his enemy. No matter what he would like to do, everything is intercepted and altered by Ouspensky. Ouspensky is his enemy. Ouspensky's desires, tastes, sympathies, antipathies, thoughts, opinions are either opposed to his own views, feelings and moods, or they have nothing in common with them. And, at the same time, Ouspensky is his master. He is the slave. He has no will of his own. He has no means of expressing his desires because whatever he would like to do or say would be done for him by Ouspensky. On this level of self-observation, a man must understand that his whole aim is to free himself from Ouspensky. And since he cannot in fact free himself from Ouspensky because he is himself, he must therefore master Ouspensky and make him do not what the Ouspensky of the given moment wants, but what he himself wants to do. From being the master, Ouspensky must become the servant. The first stage of work on oneself consists in separating oneself from Ouspensky mentally, in being separated from him in actual fact, in keeping apart from him. But the fact must be borne in mind that the whole attention must be concentrated upon Ouspensky, for a man is unable to explain what he himself really is. But he can explain Ouspensky to himself, and with this he must begin remembering at the same time that he is not Ouspensky. The most dangerous thing in this case is to rely on one's own judgment. If a man is lucky, he may at this time have someone near him who can tell him where he is and where Ouspensky is. But he must moreover trust this person, because he will undoubtedly think that he understands everything himself and that he knows where he is and where Ouspensky is. And not only in relation to himself, but in relation also to other people, will he think that he knows and sees their Ouspenskys. All this is, of course, self-deception. At this stage, a man can see nothing either in relation to himself or to others. The more convinced he is that he can, the more he is mistaken. But if he can be even to a slight extent sincere with himself and really wants to know the truth, then he can find an exact and infallible basis for judging rightly first about himself and then about other people. But the whole point lies in being sincere with oneself, and this is by no means easy. People do not understand that sincerity must be learned. They imagine that to be sincere or not to be sincere depends upon their desire or decision. But how can a man be sincere with himself when in actual fact he sincerely does not see what he ought to see in himself? Someone has to show it to him. And his attitude towards the person who shows him must be a right one, that is, such as will help him to see what is shown him and not. As often happens, hinders him if he begins to think that he already knows better. This is a very serious moment in the work. A man who loses his direction at this moment will never find it again afterwards. It must be remembered that man, such as he is, does not possess the means of distinguishing I and Ouspensky in himself. Even if he tries to, he will lie to himself and invent things, and he will never see himself as he really is. It must be understood that without outside help, a man can never see himself. In order to know why this is so, you must remember a great deal of what has been said earlier. As was said earlier, self-observation brings a man to the realization of the fact that he does not remember himself. Man's inability to remember himself is one of the chief and most characteristic features of his being and the cause of everything else in him. The inability to remember oneself finds expression in many ways. A man does not remember his decisions. He does not remember the promises he has made to himself, does not remember what he said or felt a month, a week, a day, or even an hour ago. He begins work of some kind, and after a certain lapse of time, he does not remember why he began it. It is especially in connection with work on oneself that this happens particularly often. A man can remember a promise given to another person only with the help of artificial associations. Associations which have been educated into him, and they, in their turn, are connected with conceptions which are also artificially created of honour, honesty, duty, and so on. But speaking in general, one can say truthfully that if a man remembers one thing, he forgets 10 other things which are much more important for him to remember. And a man particularly easily forgets what relates to himself, those mental photographs of himself which perhaps he has previously taken. And this deprives man's views and opinions of any stability and precision. A man does not remember what he has thought or what he has said, and he does not remember how he thought or how he spoke. This, in its turn, is connected with one of the fundamental characteristics of man's attitude towards himself and to all his surroundings, namely his constant identification with what at a given moment has attracted his attention, his thoughts or his desires, and his imagination. Identification is so common a quality that for purposes of observation, it is difficult to separate it from everything else. Man is always in a state of identification, only the object of identification changes. A man identifies with a small problem which confronts him, and he completely forgets the great aims with which he began his work. He identifies with one thought and forgets other thoughts. He is identified with one feeling, with one mood, and forgets his own wider thoughts, emotions, and moods. In work on themselves, people are so much identified with separate aims that they fail to see the wood for the trees. Two or three trees nearest to them represent for them the whole wood. Identifying is one of our most terrible foes because it penetrates everywhere and deceives a man at the moment when it seems to him that he is struggling with it. It is especially difficult to free oneself from identifying because a man naturally becomes more easily identified with the things that interest him most, to which he gives his time, his work, and his attention. In order to free himself from identifying, a man must be constantly on guard and be merciless with himself. That is, he must not be afraid of seeing all the subtle and hidden forms which identifying takes. It is necessary to see and to study identifying to its very roots in oneself. The difficulty of struggling with identifying is still further increased by the fact that when people observe it in themselves, they consider it a very good trait and call it enthusiasm, zeal, passion, spontaneity, inspiration, and names of that kind. And they consider that only in a state of identifying can a man really produce good work, no matter in what sphere. In reality, of course, this is illusion. Man cannot do anything sensible when he is in a state of identifying. If people could see what the state of identifying means, they would alter their opinions. A man becomes a thing, a piece of flesh. He loses even the small semblance of a human being that he has. In the East, where people smoke hashish and other drugs, it often happens that a man becomes so identified with his pipe that he begins to consider he is a pipe himself. This is not a joke, but a fact. He actually becomes a pipe. This is identifying. And for this, hashish or opium are entirely unnecessary. Look at people in shops, in theatres, in restaurants, or see how they identify with words when they argue about something or try to prove something, particularly something they do not know themselves. They become greediness, desires, or words. Of themselves, nothing remains. Identifying is the chief obstacle to self-remembering. A man who identifies with anything is unable to remember himself. In order to remember oneself, it is necessary, first of all, not to identify. But in order to learn not to identify, man must first of all not be identified with himself, must not call himself I always and on all occasions. He must remember that there are two in him, that there is himself, that is, I in him, and there is another with whom he must struggle and whom he must conquer if he wishes at any time to attain anything. So long as a man identifies or can be identified, he is the slave of everything that can happen to him. Freedom is first of all freedom from identification. After general forms of identification, attention must be given to a particular form of identifying, namely identifying with people, which takes the form of considering them. There are several different kinds of considering. On the most prevalent occasions, a man is identified with what others think about him, how they treat him, what attitude they show towards him. He always thinks that people do not value him enough, are not sufficiently polite and courteous. All this torments him, makes him think and suspect and lose an immense amount of energy on guesswork, on suppositions, develops in him a distrustful and hostile attitude towards people. How somebody looked at him, what somebody thought of him, what somebody said of him. All this acquires for him an immense signification. And he considers not only separate persons, but society and historically constituted conditions. Everything that displeases such a man seems to him to be unjust, illegal, wrong, and illogical. And the point of departure for his judgment is always that these things can and should be changed. Injustice is one of the words in which very often considering hides itself. When a man has convinced himself that he is indignant with some injustice, then for him to stop considering would mean reconciling himself to injustice. There are people who are able to consider not only injustice or the failure of others to value them enough, but who are able to consider, for example, the weather. This seems ridiculous, but it is a fact. People are able to consider climate, heat, cold, snow, rain. They can be irritated by the weather, be indignant and angry with it. A man can take everything in such a personal way as though everything in the world had been specially arranged in order to give him pleasure, or on the contrary, to cause him inconvenience or unpleasantness. All this and much else besides is merely a form of identification. Such considering is wholly based upon requirements. A man inwardly requires that everyone should see what a remarkable man he is, and that they should constantly give expression to their respect, esteem, and admiration for him, for his intellect, his beauty, his cleverness, his wit, his presence of mind, his originality, and all his other qualities. Requirements in their turn are based on a completely fantastic notion about themselves, such as very often occurs with people of very modest appearance. Various writers, actors, musicians, artists, and politicians, for instance, are almost without exception sick people. And what are they suffering from? First of all, from an extraordinary opinion of themselves, then from requirements, and then from considering. That is, being ready and prepared beforehand to take offence at lack of understanding and lack of appreciation. There is still another form of considering, which can take a great deal of energy from a man. This form starts with a man beginning to think that he is not considering another person enough, that this other person is offended with him for not considering him sufficiently. And he begins to think himself that perhaps he does not think enough about this other, does not pay him enough attention, does not give way to him enough. All this is simply weakness. People are afraid of one another. But this can lead very far. I have seen many such cases. In this way, a man can finally lose his balance, if at any time he had any, and begin to perform entirely senseless actions. He gets angry with himself and feels that it is stupid and he cannot stop. Whereas in such cases, the whole point is precisely not to consider. It is the same case, only perhaps worse, when a man considers that in his opinion he ought to do something when, as a matter of fact, he ought not to do so at all. Ought and ought not is also a difficult subject. That is, difficult to understand when a man really ought and when he ought not. This can be approached only from the point of view of aim. When a man has an aim, he ought to do only what leads him towards his aim, and he ought not to do anything that hinders him from going towards his aim. As I've already said, people very often think that if they begin to struggle with considering within themselves, It will make them insincere. And they are afraid of this because they think that in this event they will be losing something, losing a part of themselves. In this case, the same thing takes place as in attempts to struggle against the outward expression of unpleasant emotions. The sole difference is that in one case a man struggles with the outward expression of emotions, and in the other case with an inner manifestation of perhaps the same emotions. This fear of losing sincerity is, of course, self-deception, one of those formulas of line upon which human weaknesses are based. Man cannot help identifying and considering inwardly, and he cannot help expressing his unpleasant emotions simply because he is weak. Identifying, considering, the expression of unpleasant emotions are manifestations of his weakness, his impotence, his inability to control himself. But not wishing to acknowledge this weakness to himself, he calls it sincerity or honesty, and he tells himself that he does not want to struggle against sincerity, whereas in fact he is unable to struggle against his weaknesses. Sincerity and honesty are in reality something quite different. What a man calls sincerity in this case is in reality simply being unwilling to restrain himself. And deep down inside him a man is aware of this. But he lies to himself when he says that he does not want to lose sincerity. So far, I have spoken of internal considering. It would be possible to bring forward many more examples, but you must do this yourselves. That is, you must seek these examples in your observations of yourselves and of others. The opposite of internal considering, and what is in part a means of fighting against it, is external considering. External considering is based upon an entirely different relationship towards people than internal considering. It is adaptation towards people, to their understanding, to their requirements. By considering externally, a man does that which makes life easy for other people and for himself. External considering requires a knowledge of men, an understanding of their tastes, habits, and prejudices. At the same time, external considering requires a great power over oneself, a great control over oneself. Very often a man desires sincerely to express or somehow or other show to another man what he really thinks of him or feels about him. And if he is a weak man, he will of course give way to this desire and afterwards justify himself and say that he did not want to lie, did not want to pretend, he wanted to be sincere. Then he convinces himself that it was the other man's fault. He really wanted to consider him, even to give way to him, not to quarrel, and so on. But the other man did not at all want to consider him, so that nothing could be done with him. It very often happens that a man begins with a blessing and ends with a curse. He begins by deciding not to consider, and afterwards blames other people for not considering him. This is an example of how external considering passes into internal considering. But if a man really remembers himself, he understands that another man is a machine just as he is himself. And then he will enter into his position, he will put himself in his place, and he will be really able to understand and feel what another man thinks and feels. If he can do this, his work becomes easier for him. But if he approaches a man with his own requirements, nothing except new internal considering can ever be obtained from it. Right external considering is very important in the work. It often happens that people who understand very well the necessity of external considering in life do not understand the necessity of external considering in the work. They decide that just because they are in the work, they have the right not to consider. Whereas in reality, in the work, that is for a man's own successful work, 10 times more external considering is necessary than in life, because only external considering on his part shows his valuation of the work and his understanding of the work, and success in the work is always proportional to the valuation and understanding of it. Remember that work cannot begin and cannot proceed on a level lower than that of the Oberwettel, that is, on a level lower than ordinary life. This is a very important principle, which for some reason or other is very easily forgotten. But we will speak about this separately afterwards. G began one of the following talks with the fact that we forget about the difficulties of our position. "You often think in a very naive way," he said. "You already think you can do. To get rid of this conviction is more difficult than anything else for a man. You do not understand all the complexity of your organisation, and you do not realise that every effort, in addition to the results desired, even if it gives these, gives thousands of unexpected and often undesirable results. And the chief thing that you forget is that you are not beginning from the beginning with a nice, clean, new machine. There stand between you many years of a wrong and stupid life, of indulgence in every kind of weakness, of shutting your eyes to your own errors, of striving to avoid all unpleasant truths, of constant lying to yourselves, of self-justification, of blaming others, and so on and so on. All this cannot help affecting the machine. The machine is dirty. In places it is rusty, and in some places artificial appliances have been formed, the necessity for which has been created by its own wrong way of working. These artificial appliances will now interfere very much with all your good intentions. They are called buffers. Buffer is a term which requires special explanation. We know what buffers on railway carriages are. They are the contrivances which lessen the shock when carriage or truck strike one another. If there were no buffers, the shock of one carriage against another would be very unpleasant and dangerous. Buffers soften the results of these shocks and render them unnoticeable and imperceptible. Exactly the same appliances are to be found within man. They are created, not by nature, but by man himself, although involuntarily. The cause of their appearance is the existence in man of many contradictions, contradictions of opinions, feelings, sympathies, words, and actions. If a man throughout the whole of his life were to feel all the contradictions that are within him, he could not live and act as calmly as he lives and acts now. He would have constant friction, constant unrest. We fail to see how contradictory and hostile the different eyes of our personality are to one another. If a man were to feel all these contradictions, he would feel what he really is. He would feel that he is mad. It is not pleasant to anyone to feel that he is mad. Moreover, a fault such as this deprives a man of self-confidence, weakens his energy, deprives him of self-respect. Somehow or other, he must master this fault or banish it. He must either destroy contradictions or cease to see and to feel them. A man cannot destroy contradictions. But if buffers are created in him, he can cease to feel them, and he will not feel the impact from the clash of contradictory views, contradictory emotions, contradictory words. Buffers are created slowly and gradually. Very many buffers are created artificially through education. Others are created under the hypnotic influence of all surrounding life. A man is surrounded by people who live, speak, think, and feel by means of buffers. Imitating them in their opinions, actions, and words, a man involuntarily creates similar buffers in himself. Buffers make a man's life more easy. It is very hard to live without buffers, but they keep man from the possibility of inner development, because buffers are made to lessen shocks, and it is only shocks that can lead a man out of the state in which he lives, that is, waken him. Buffers lull a man to sleep, give him the agreeable and peaceful sensation that all will be well, that no contradictions exist, and that he can sleep in peace. Buffers are appliances by means of which a man can always be in the right. Buffers help a man not to feel his conscience. Conscience is again a term that needs explanation. In ordinary life, the concept conscience is taken too simply, as if we had a conscience. Actually, the concept conscience in the sphere of the emotions is equivalent to the concept consciousness in the sphere of the intellect. And as we have no consciousness, we have no conscience. Consciousness is a state in which a man knows all at once everything that he in general knows, and in which he can see how little he does know, and how many contradictions there are in what he knows. Conscience is a state in which a man feels all at once everything that he in general feels or can feel. And as everyone has within him thousands of contradictory feelings which vary from a deeply hidden realization of his own nothingness and fears of all kinds to the most stupid kind of self-conceit, self-confidence, self-satisfaction and self-praise, to feel all this together would not only be painful, but literally unbearable. If a man whose entire inner world is composed of contradictions were suddenly to feel all these contradictions simultaneously within himself, if he were to feel all at once that he loves everything he hates and hates everything he loves, that he lies when he tells the truth and that he tells the truth when he lies, if he could feel the shame and horror of it all, this would be the state which is called conscience. A man cannot live in this state. He must either destroy contradictions or destroy conscience. He cannot destroy conscience, but if he cannot destroy it, he can put it to sleep. That is, he can separate by impenetrable barriers one feeling of self from another, never see them together, never feel their incompatibility, the absurdity of one's existing alongside another. But fortunately for man, that is, for his peace and for his sleep, this state of conscience is very rare. From early childhood, buffers begin to grow and strengthen in him, taking from him the possibility of seeing his inner contradictions, and therefore, for him, there is no danger whatever of a sudden awakening. Awakening is possible only for those who seek it and want it, for those who are ready to struggle with themselves and work on themselves for a very long time and very persistently in order to attain it. For this it is necessary to destroy buffers, that is, to go out to meet all those inner sufferings which are connected with the sensations of contradictions. Moreover, the destruction of buffers in itself requires very long work, and a man must agree to this work, realizing that the result of this work will be every possible discomfort and suffering from the awakening of his conscience. But conscience is the fire which alone can fuse all the powders in the glass retort which was mentioned before, and create the unity which a man lacks in that state in which he begins to study himself. The concept conscience has nothing in common with the concept morality. Conscience is a general and a permanent phenomenon. Conscience is the same for all men, and conscience is possible only in the absence of buffers. From the point of view of understanding the different categories of man, we may say that there exists the conscience of a man in whom there are no contradictions. This conscience is not suffering. On the contrary, it is joy of a totally new character, which we are unable to understand. But even a momentary awakening of conscience in a man who has thousands of different eyes is bound to involve suffering. And if these moments of conscience become longer, and if a man does not fear them, but on the contrary cooperates with them, and tries to keep and prolong them, an element of very subtle joy, a foretaste of the future, clear consciousness, will gradually enter into these moments. There is nothing general in the concept of morality. Morality consists of buffers. There is no general morality. What is moral in China is immoral in a Europe, and what is moral in a Europe is immoral in China. What is moral in Petersburg is immoral to the Caucasus, and what is moral in the Caucasus is immoral in Petersburg. What is moral in one class of society is immoral in another, and vice versa. Morality is always and everywhere an artificial phenomenon. It consists of various taboos, that is, restrictions, and various demands, sometimes sensible in their basis, and sometimes having lost all meaning or never even having had any meaning, and having been created on a false basis, on a soil of superstition and false fears. Morality consists of buffers, and since buffers are of various kinds, and as the conditions of life in different countries and in different ages, or among different classes of society, vary considerably, so the morality created by them is also very dissimilar and contradictory. A morality common to all does not exist. It is even impossible to say that there exists any general idea of morality, for instance, in a Europe. It is said sometimes that the general morality for Europe is Christian morality. But first of all, the idea of Christian morality itself admits of very many different interpretations, and many different crimes have been justified by Christian morality. And in the second place, modern Europe has very little in common with Christian morality, no matter how we understand this morality. In any case, if Christian morality brought a Europe to the war which is now going on, then it would be as well to be as far as possible from such morality. Many people say that they do not understand the moral side of your teaching, said one of us, and others say that your teaching has no morality at all. Of course not, said G. People are very fond of talking about morality. But morality is merely self-suggestion. What is necessary is conscience. We do not teach morality. We teach how to find conscience. People are not pleased when we say this. They say that we have no love, simply because we do not encourage weakness and hypocrisy, but, on the contrary, take off all masks. He who desires the truth will not speak of love or of Christianity, because he knows how far he is from these. Christian teaching is for Christians, and Christians are those who live, that is, who do everything according to Christ's precepts. Can they who talk of love and morality live according to Christ's precepts? Of course they cannot, but there will always be talk of this kind. There will always be people to whom words are more precious than anything else. But this is a true sign. He who speaks like this is an empty man. It is not worthwhile wasting time on him. Morality and conscience are quite different things. One conscience can never contradict another conscience. One morality can always very easily contradict and simply deny another. A man with buffers may be very moral, and buffers can be very different. That is, two very moral men may consider each other very immoral. As a rule, it is almost inevitably so. The more moral a man is, the more immoral does he think other moral people. The idea of morality is connected with the idea of good and evil conduct, but the idea of good and evil is always different for different people, always subjective in man number one, number two, and number three, and is connected only with a given moment or a given situation. A subjective man can have no general concept of good and evil. For a subjective man, evil is everything that is opposed to his desires or interests or his concept of good. One may say that evil does not exist for subjective man at all, that there exist only different conceptions of good. Nobody ever does anything deliberately in the interests of evil for the sake of evil. Everybody acts in the interests of good as he understands it. But everybody understands it in a different way. Consequently, men drown, slay, and kill one another in the interests of good. The reason is again just the same, men's ignorance and the deep sleep in which they live. This is so obvious that it even seems strange that people have never thought of it before. However, the fact remains that they fail to understand this, and everyone considers his good as the only good and all the rest as evil. It is naive and useless to hope that men will ever understand this and that they will evolve a general and identical idea of good. But do not good and evil exist in themselves apart from man? Asked someone present. They do, said G. Only this is very far away from us, and it is not worth your while even to try to understand this at present. Simply remember one thing. The only possible permanent idea of good and evil for man is connected with the idea of evolution. Not with a mechanical evolution, of course, but with the idea of man's development through conscious efforts, the change of his being, the creation of unity in him, and the formation of a permanent I. A permanent idea of good and evil can be formed in man only in connection with a permanent aim and a permanent understanding. If a man understands that he is asleep, and if he wishes to awake, then everything that helps him to awake will be good, and everything that hinders him, everything that prolongs his sleep, will be evil. Exactly in the same way will he understand what is good and evil for other people. What helps them to awake is good, what hinders them is evil. But this is so only for those who want to awake, that is, for those who understand that they are asleep. Those who do not understand that they are asleep, and those who can have no wish to awake cannot have understanding of good and evil. And as the overwhelming majority of people do not realise and will never realise that they are asleep, neither good nor evil can actually exist for them. This contradicts generally accepted ideas. People are accustomed to think that good and evil must be the same for everyone, and, above all, that good and evil exist for everyone. In reality, however, good and evil exist only for a few, for those who have an aim and who pursue that aim. Then what hinders the pursuit of that aim is evil, and what helps is good. But of course, most sleeping people will say that they have an aim and that they are going somewhere. The realization of the fact that he has no aim and that he is not going anywhere is the first sign of the approaching awakening of a man, or of awakening becoming really possible for him. Awakening begins when a man realizes that he is going nowhere and does not know where to go. As has been explained before, there are many qualities which men attribute to themselves, which in reality could belong only to people of a higher degree of development and of a higher degree of evolution than man number one, number two, and number three. Individuality, a single and permanent I, consciousness, will, the ability to do, a state of inner freedom, all these qualities which ordinary man does not possess. To the same category belongs the idea of good and evil, the very existence of which is connected with a permanent aim, with a permanent direction, and a permanent centre of gravity. The idea of good and evil is sometimes connected with the idea of truth and falsehood. But just as good and evil do not exist for ordinary man, neither do truth and falsehood exist. Permanent truth and permanent falsehood can exist only for a permanent man. If a man himself continually changes, then for him truth and falsehood will also continually change. And if people are all in different states at every given moment, their conceptions of truth must be as varied as their conceptions of good. A man never notices how he begins to regard as true what yesterday he considered as false and vice versa. He does not notice these transitions just as he does not notice the transitions of his own eyes one into another. In the life of an ordinary man, truth and falsehood have no moral value of any kind because a man can never keep to one single truth. His truth changes. If for a certain time it does not change, it is simply because it is kept by buffers and a man can never tell the truth. Sometimes it tells the truth, sometimes it tells a lie. Consequently, his truth and his falsehood have no value. Neither of them depends upon him. Both of them depend upon accident. And this is equally true when applied to a man's words, to his thoughts, his feelings, and to his conceptions of truth and falsehood. In order to understand the interrelation of truth and falsehood in life, a man must understand falsehood in himself, the constant, incessant lies he tells himself. These lies are created by buffers. In order to destroy the lies in oneself, as well as lies told unconsciously to others, buffers must be destroyed. But then a man cannot live without buffers. Buffers automatically control a man's actions, words, thoughts, and feelings. If buffers were to be destroyed, all control would disappear. A man cannot exist without control, even though it is only automatic control. Only a man who possesses will, that is, conscious control, can live without buffers. Consequently, if a man begins to destroy buffers within himself, he must at the same time develop a will. And as will cannot be created to order in a short space of time, a man may be left with buffers demolished and with a will that is not as yet sufficiently strengthened. The only chance he has during this period is to be controlled by another will which has already been strengthened. This is why in schoolwork, which includes the destruction of buffers, a man must be ready to obey another man's will so long as his own will is not yet fully developed. Usually this subordination to another man's will is studied before anything else. I use the word studied because a man must understand why such obedience is necessary, and he must learn to obey. The latter is not at all easy. A man beginning the work of self-study with the object of attaining control over himself is accustomed to believe in his own decisions. Even the fact that he has seen the necessity for changing himself shows him that his decisions are correct and strengthens his belief in them. But when he begins to work on himself, a man must give up his own decisions, sacrifice his own decisions, because otherwise, the will of the man who directs his work will not be able to control his actions. In schools of the religious way, obedience is demanded before anything else, that is full and unquestioning submission, although without understanding. Schools of the fourth way demand understanding before anything else. Results of efforts are always proportional to understanding. Renunciation of his own decisions, subordination to the will of another, may present insuperable difficulties to a man if he had failed to realise beforehand that actually he neither sacrifices nor changes anything in his life, that all his life he has been subject to some extraneous will and has never had any decisions of his own. But a man is not conscious of this. He considers that he has the right of free choice. It is hard for him to renounce the illusion that he directs and organises his life himself. But no work on himself is possible until a man is free from this illusion. He must realise that he does not exist. He must realise that he can lose nothing because he has nothing to lose. He must realise his nothingness in the full sense of the term. This consciousness of one's nothingness alone can conquer the fear of subordination to the will of another. However strange it may seem, this fear is actually one of the most serious obstacles on a man's path. A man is afraid that he will be made to do things that are opposed to his principles, views, and ideas. Moreover, this fear immediately creates in him the illusion that he really has principles, views, and convictions, which in reality he never has had and never could have. A man who has never in his life thought of morality suddenly begins to fear that he will be made to do something immoral. A man who has never thought of his health and who has done everything possible to ruin it begins to fear that he will be made to do something which will injure it. A man who has lied to everyone, everywhere, all his life, in the most barefaced manner, begins suddenly to fear that he will be made to tell lies, and so on without end. I knew a drunkard who was afraid more than anything else that he would be made to drink. The fear of being subordinated to another man's will very often proves stronger than anything else. A man does not realise that a subordination to which he consciously agrees is the only way to acquire a will of his own. Next time, G began again with the question of will. The question of will, of one's own will and of another man's will, is much more complicated than it seems at the first glance. A man has not sufficient will to do, that is, to control himself and all his actions, but he has sufficient will to obey another person. And only in this way can he escape from the law of accident. There is no other way. I mentioned before about fate and accident in man's life. We will now take the meaning of these words in more detail. Fate also exists, but not for everyone. Most people are separated from their fate and live under the law of accident only. Fate is the result of planetary influences which correspond to a man's type. We will speak about types later. In the meantime, you must grasp one thing. A man can have the fate which corresponds to his type, but he practically never does have it. This arises because fate has relation to only one part of man, namely to his essence. It must be understood that man consists of two parts, essence and personality. Essence in man is what is his own. Personality in man is what is not his own. Not his own means what has come from outside, what he has learned or reflects, all traces of exterior impressions left in the memory and in the sensations, all words and movements that have been learned, all feelings created by imitation. All this is not his own. All this is personality. From the point of view of ordinary psychology, the division of man into personality and essence is hardly comprehensible. It is more exact to say that such a division does not exist in psychology at all. A small child has no personality as yet. He is what he really is. He is essence. His desires, tastes, likes, dislikes express his being such as it is. But as soon as so-called education begins, personality begins to grow. Personality is created partly by the intentional influences of other people, that is, by education, and partly by involuntary imitation of them by the child itself. In the creation of personality, a great part is also played by resistance to people around him, and by attempts to conceal from them something that is his own or real. Essence is the truth in man, personality is the false. But in proportion as personality grows, essence manifests itself more and more rarely and more feebly, and it very often happens that essence stops in its growth at a very early age and grows no further. It happens very often that the essence of a grown-up man, even that of a very intellectual and, in the accepted meaning of the word, highly educated man, stops on the level of a child of 5 or 6. This means that everything we see in this man is in reality not his own. What is own in man, that is, his essence, is usually only manifested in his instincts and in his simplest emotions. There are cases, however, when a man's essence grows in parallel with his personality. Such cases represent very rare exceptions, especially in the circumstances of cultured life. Essence has more chances of development in men who live nearer to nature in difficult conditions of constant struggle and danger. But as a rule, the personality of such people is very little developed. They have more of what is their own, but very little of what is not their own. That is to say, they lack education and instruction. They lack culture. Culture creates personality and is at the same time the product and the result of personality. We do not realize that the whole of our life, all we call civilization, all we call science, philosophy, art and politics, is created by people's personality, that is, by what is not their own in them. The element that is not his own differs from what is man's own by the fact that it can be lost, altered, or taken away by artificial means. There exists a possibility of experimental verification of the relation of personality to essence. In Eastern schools, ways and means are known by the help of which it is possible to separate man's personality from his essence. For this purpose, they sometimes use hypnosis, sometimes special narcotics, sometimes certain kind of exercises. If personality and essence are for a time separated in a man by one or another of these means, two beings, as it were, are formed in him, who speak in different voices, have completely different tastes, aims and interests, and one of these two beings often proves to be on the level of a small child. Continuing the experiment further, it is possible to put one of these beings to sleep, or the experiment may begin by putting to sleep either personality or essence. Certain narcotics have the property of putting personality to sleep without affecting essence. And for a certain time after taking this narcotic, a man's personality disappears, as it were, and only his essence remains. And it happens that a man full of the most varied and exalted ideas, full of sympathies and antipathies, love, hatred, attachments, patriotism, habits, tastes, desires, convictions, suddenly proves quite empty, without thoughts, without feelings, without convictions, without views. Everything that has agitated him before now leaves him completely indifferent. Sometimes he sees the artificiality and the imaginary character of his usual moods or his high-sounding words. Sometimes he simply forgets them as though they had never existed. Things for which he was ready to sacrifice his life now appear to him ridiculous and meaningless and unworthy of his attention. All that he can find in himself is a small number of instinctive inclinations and tastes. He is fond of sweets. He likes warmth. He dislikes cold. He dislikes the thought of work, or on the contrary, he likes the idea of physical movement. And that is all. Sometimes, though very seldom, and sometimes when it is least expected. Essence proves fully grown and fully developed in a man, even in cases of undeveloped personality. And in this case, essence unites together everything that is serious and real in a man. But this happens very seldom. As a rule, a man's essence is either primitive, savage, and childish, or else simply stupid. The development of essence depends on work on oneself. A very important moment in the work on oneself is when a man begins to distinguish between his personality and his essence. A man's real I, his individuality, can grow only from his essence. It can be said that a man's individuality is his essence, grown up, mature. But in order to enable essence to grow up, it is first of all necessary to weaken the constant pressure of personality upon it, because the obstacles to the growth of essence are contained in personality. If we take an average cultured man, we shall see that in the vast majority of cases his personality is the active element in him, while his essence is the passive element. The inner growth of a man cannot begin so long as this order of things remains unchanged. Personality must become passive and essence must become active. This can happen only if buffers are removed or weakened, because buffers are the chief weapon by the help of which personality holds essence in subjection. As has been said earlier, in the case of less cultured people, essence is often more highly developed than it is in cultured man. It would seem that they ought to be nearer the possibility of growth, but in reality it is not so, because their personality proves to be insufficiently developed. For inner growth, for work on oneself, a certain development of personality as well as a certain strength of essence are necessary. Personality consists of roles and of buffers resulting from a certain work of the centres. An insufficiently developed personality means a lack of roles, that is, a lack of knowledge, a lack of information, a lack of the material upon which work on oneself must be based. Without some store of knowledge, without a certain amount of material, not his own, a man cannot begin to work on himself. He cannot begin to study himself. He cannot begin to struggle with his mechanical habits, simply because there will be no reason or motive for undertaking such work. It does not mean that all the ways are closed to him. The way of the fakir and the way of the monk, which do not require any intellectual development, remain open to him. But the methods and the means which are possible for a man of a developed intellect are impossible for him. Thus, evolution is equally difficult for a cultured or an uncultured man. A cultured man lives far from nature, far from natural conditions of existence, in artificial conditions of life, developing his personality at the expense of his essence. A less cultured man, living in more normal and more natural conditions, develops his essence at the expense of his personality. A successful beginning of work on oneself requires the happy occurrence of an equal development of personality and essence. Such an occurrence will give the greatest assurance of success. If essence is very little developed, a long, preparatory period of work is required, and this work will be quite fruitless if a man's essence is rotten inside, or if it develops some irreparable defects. Conditions of this kind occur fairly often. An abnormal development of personality very often arrests the development of essence at such an early stage that the essence becomes a small deformed thing. From a small deformed thing, nothing else can be got. Moreover, it happens fairly often that essence dies in a man while his personality and his body are still alive. A considerable percentage of the people we meet in the streets of a great town are people who are empty inside, that is, they are actually already dead. It is fortunate for us that we do not see and do not know it. If we knew what a number of people are actually dead and what a number of these dead people govern our lives, we should go mad with horror. And indeed, people often do go mad because they find out something of this nature without the proper preparation, that is, they see something they are not supposed to see. In order to see without danger, one must be on the way. If a man who can do nothing sees the truth, he will certainly go mad. Only this rarely happens. Usually everything is so arranged that a man can see nothing prematurely. Personality sees only what it likes to see and what does not interfere with its life. It never sees what it does not like. This is both good and bad at the same time. It is good if a man wants to sleep, bad if he wants to awaken. If essence is subject to the influence of fate, does it mean that compared with accident, fate is always favourable to a man or somebody present? And can fate bring a man to the work? No, it does not mean this at all, G answered. Fate is better than accident only in the sense that it is possible to take it into account. It is possible to know it beforehand. It is possible to prepare for what is ahead. In regard to accident, one can know nothing. But fate can be also unpleasant or difficult. In this event, however, there are means for isolating oneself from one's fate. The first step towards this consists in getting away from general laws. Just as there is individual accident, so is there general or collective accident. And in the same way as there is individual fate, there is a general or collective fate. Collective accident and collective fate are governed by general laws. If a man wishes to create individuality of his own, he must free himself from general laws. General laws are by no means all obligatory for man. He can free himself from many of them if he frees himself from buffers and from imagination. All this is connected with liberation from personality. Personality feeds on imagination and falsehood. If the falsehood in which man lives is decreased and imagination is decreased, personality very soon weakens and a man begins to be controlled either by fate or by a line of work, which is in its turn controlled by another man's will. This will lead him until a will of his own has been formed, capable of withstanding both accident and, when necessary, fate. The talks given embrace a period of a few months. It stands to reason that it is not possible to re-establish the talks in their exact order, because very often G touched upon 20 different subjects in an evening. Much was repeated, much depended upon the questions asked by those present. Many ideas were so closely connected that they could only be separated artificially. At this time, certain definite types of people had already begun to show a negative attitude towards our work. Besides the absence of love, many people were very indignant at the demand for payment for money. In this connection, it was very characteristic that those who were indignant were not those who could pay only with difficulty, but people of means for whom the sum demanded was a mere trifle. Those who could not pay or who could pay very little always understood that they could not count upon getting something for nothing, and that G's work, his journeys to Petersburg, and the time that he and others gave to the work cost money. Only those who had money did not understand and did not want to understand this. Does this mean that we must pay to enter the kingdom of heaven? They said. People do not pay, nor is money asked for such things. Christ said to his disciples, take neither purse nor scrip, and you want 1,000 rubles. A very good business could be made of it. Suppose that you had 100 members. This would already make 100,000, and if there were 200, 300, 300,000 a year is very good money. G always smiled when I told him about talks like this. Take neither purse nor scrip, and need not a railway ticket be taken either. The hotel paid. You see how much falsehood and hypocrisy there is here. No, even if we needed no money at all, it would still be necessary to keep this payment. It rids us at once of many useless people. Nothing shows up people so much as their attitude towards money. They are ready to waste as much as you like on their own personal fantasies, but they have no valuation whatever of another person's labour. I must work for them and give them gratis everything that they vouchsafe to take from me. How is it possible to trade in knowledge? This ought to be free. It is precisely for this reason that the demand for this payment is necessary. Some people will never pass this barrier, and if they do not pass this one, it means that they will never pass another. Besides, there are other considerations. Afterwards, you will see. The other considerations were very simple ones. Many people indeed could not pay. And although in principle G put the question very strictly, in practice he never refused anybody on the grounds that they had no money. And it was found out later that he even supported many of his pupils. The people who paid 1,000 rubles paid not only for themselves, but for others.